Let us stand and we'll start our service by singing together, Jesus Christ is risen today. Well, happy Easter, everyone. It's good to see you all here, bright and early. Chocolates all finished, eggs cracked, all those good things have happened. Hope the bunny came. Sorry? You wait until you get home. Poor. Gee, that's tough, isn't it? So, friends, alleluia, Christ is risen. This is the day the Lord has made. Brightness of God's glory, whom death could not conquer nor the tomb imprison. As you have shed our frailty in human flesh, help us to share your immortality in the spirit. Let no shadow of the grave terrify us, and no fear of darkness turn our hearts from you. Reveal yourself to us this day and all our days, as the first and the last, the living one, our immortal Saviour and Lord. And let us sing the Gloria together.
Thank you.
So friends, let's be seated as we listen to our readings from Scripture, and the first one is from the prophet Isaiah.
It does help to have the microphone turned on, so happy Easter, everybody. So the first reading is from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 21, beginning at verse 6. On this mountain the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-matured wines, of rich food filled with the marrow, of well-matured wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. And the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, "Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation." Hear the word of the Lord.
Anthem, please join in bold type. Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. Not with the old leaven of corruption and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Christ, once raised from the dead, dies no more. Death has no more dominion over him. In dying, he died to sin once for all. And living lives to God. See yourselves, therefore, as dead to sin, and alive to God in Jesus Christ. Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who sleep. For as by man came death, by man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For us, as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and forever. Amen.
The second reading comes from the Acts of the Apostles, Chapter 10, beginning at verse 34. Then Peter began to speak to them. "I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all." That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Hear the word of the Lord.
And our gradual hymn, Alleluia, Alleluia, give thanks to the risen Lord. Friends, may the Lord be with you. We have a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark, chapter 16, beginning at the first verse. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They'd been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you'll see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Hear the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. May your words live in us and bear much fruit to your glory. So let's be seated. Well, Easter Sunday has become a day of great celebrations. It's a time when many people travel. They gather with families, cook up meals, eat chocolate, have drinks. Some go camping for some reason. They do all sorts of things. Some come to church. We focus on the resurrection of Christ. And the resurrection of Christ demands a response from us. We've just heard from Mark chapter 16, the last chapter of Mark's gospel, about this resurrection. And you should walk away changed in some way. Because it's impossible to truly confront this historical reality and walk away unchanged. As you read this chapter, what you see first is that people didn't anticipate the resurrection. They weren't expecting Jesus to rise from the dead at all. And we hear that after the Sabbath, three women, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome, went to Jesus' tomb to anoint his body with spices. And their big worry was, who is going to roll away the stone from the entrance of the tomb? Clearly, they were expecting to find a sealed tomb. They're expecting to find a body. They didn't anticipate the resurrection at all. But why not? Jesus had told them several times exactly what was going to happen. Why weren't all his followers gathered outside the tomb to see Jesus alive? Good question. Why weren't they at least thinking it might happen? Well, the notion of someone dying and coming back to life is crazy. People don't rise from the dead after dying, both back then and now. Especially from such a public and gruesome death. So the women had every reason to think that Jesus would still be dead when they approached the tomb, just like we would. They were getting ready, in a sense, to put Jesus behind them, to draw the line in the sand and move on with their lives. But what happened next changed everything. In verses 4 to 5, the women see that the stone has actually been rolled away, that the body is gone. And there's this mysterious angel-like person inside who tells them two things. Jesus is not here, and tell his disciples to go to Galilee and continue the mission. Look, the resurrection is a big deal. But The messenger in the gospel doesn't dwell on it. He's just like a sticky note left there for those who show up first. But the point was, Jesus was alive. And now there's work to be done. God's purposes were not thwarted by the cross. No, they were fulfilled by the cross. And the disciples had to move forward. As awesome as the resurrection is, it's not actually the resurrection that's special. What's special is that Jesus is alive. And with that message that Jesus is alive, the disciples made disciples, baptizing and teaching them about what Jesus commanded. And those disciples did the same thing, on and on and on, all the way to us, because Jesus is alive. The resurrection is an explosive event in history. And it not only emboldened the disciples, but it started the church. It started all of this, and it continues today. The message of the resurrection isn't come back and live in the empty tomb. The message of the resurrection is onward. Go out. Tell others. So, we must not merely celebrate the resurrection. No, we must respond to it. So do not memorialize Jesus. Rather, trust him and follow him. Do not commemorate Jesus, but rather, dedicate your life to him as your living Lord. But reading about the resurrection isn't the important thing at all. No, it's how you respond to it that's important. The women were to respond by telling the disciples. And in Mark's gospel, they were afraid and told no one, but obviously they did. The disciples were to respond by obeying Jesus' great commission. Go out and baptize in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So look, if you believe that Jesus was raised from the dead, the only valid response is actually to surrender your life to him. Is to place your life in the hands of the risen Lord. To open your heart. If you believe in the resurrection of Jesus, you are not allowed to ignore the resurrection. You can only reject it completely. Or give yourself to it. The messenger said to those women, "You're looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. Go and tell the disciples." Friends, Christ is risen. Evil has fallen. Christ is risen, and the angels rejoice. Christ is risen, and life reigns. Christ is risen indeed from the dead, the first of all who have fallen asleep. Glory and power to him forever and ever.
In the joy of the risen Christ and before one another, we declare and reaffirm our faith in the words of the Creed and the promises of commitment.
Let us stand.
I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Friends, in this part of the service, we renew our baptismal vows. And so, as we do that, we remember that at some point in history, as a baby or later in life, more than likely we were baptized and our life was given over to Christ. We died with him and rose with him. So I'll ask you these questions that were asked at the time of your baptism. Hopefully, you will respond. I ask you, do you turn to Christ? I ask you, do you repent of your sins? Do you reject selfish living and all that is false and unjust? Do you renounce Satan and all evil? Do you now ask for renewal in the faith which you have professed? Will you, with God's help, strive to keep his holy will and commandments and serve him faithfully throughout your lives? And last night at our Easter Eve service, we blessed the water in the baptismal font, which will be used later today for a number of baptisms. So I'll go around now and I'll sprinkle you with the blessed water, reminding you of your baptism. I'll come up each side. So it is a reminder of our baptism. It's a reminder of our entry into the Lord's death. It's a reminder of his resurrection and that we are Christ's own forever. So knowing that, let us perhaps sit or kneel as we pray to that God, the God who loves us, the God who raised Christ from the dead.
Praise and honour to you, Lord Jesus Christ, for you have triumphed gloriously. We give you thanks and pray for your world, for the welfare of all your people, and for your creation entrusted to our care, for all in positions of authority, for men and women in their daily work. Roll away the stones of hatred and greed. Transform us with your spirit of justice and righteousness, and all your people may share in the joy of your risen life. Risen God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give you thanks and pray for your worldwide church, for our brothers and sisters in Christ, for the clergy and people of this parish, and for all who make or renew baptismal vows today. Roll away the stones of discord and unbelief. Transform your church with your spirit of wisdom and truth, that we may be witnesses to your risen life in this world. Risen God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give you thanks and pray for the communities in which we live and work, for ourselves, our families and friends, and for all whom we love. We pray for the forgotten and undervalued people of society, that they will find support and comfort. Roll away the stones of apathy and selfishness. Transform our lives with your spirit of love and forgiveness, that we may share in the joy of your risen life. Risen God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give you thanks for what we have received in this life and what we have to share. We pray for all who suffer, for the hungry and homeless, the lonely and friendless, for the sick and the sorrowing, for all who care for them, and for our responses when challenged. Roll away the stones of pain and despair. Transform the lives of all who suffer with your comfort and healing, that they may share in the hope of your risen life. Risen God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give you thanks for your faithful people of every age, for all those gone before us in our lives and from this parish. Transform our lives by your risen power, that we, with all your saints, may come to share forever in the glory of your risen life. Risen God, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We pause a moment as we place our own prayers in God's hands too. Lord of heaven and earth, we place into your hands the prayers that we say aloud, but the many prayers of our hearts that you alone know. We ask that you hear them. We ask that you grant them through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We stand for the peace. Friends, Christ is risen. Alleluia. And may the peace of the Lord, crucified and risen, be always with you. Thank you. Let's offer a sign of peace. So, friends, we will sing our hymn, Hallelujah, Sing to Jesus, as we prepare the altar and as we take up our collection. And friends, may the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let's give thanks to the Lord our God. All glory and honor, thanks and praise be yours always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever-living God. We give you thanks and praise for your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, who by the power of your Spirit was born of Mary and lived as one of us. Father, by his death on the cross, he offered the one true sacrifice for sin and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. And now we give you thanks that you raised him to life triumphant and exalted him to glory. Father, by his victory over death, the reign of sin is ended. A new day has dawned. A broken world is restored. And we are made whole once again. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. Merciful God, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, for this bread and for this wine. And we pray that we who eat and drink them in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, in remembrance of the death and passion of your Son, may be partakers of his body and blood. Father, on the night before Jesus died, he gathered in the community with his disciples. While they're eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it. He gave it to them and said, "Take, this is my body." Then, Father, he took a cup, and after giving you thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." Therefore, with this bread and this cup, we do as our Saviour has commanded. We celebrate the redemption he has won for us. We proclaim his perfect sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. And we look for his coming to fulfill all things according to your will. Father, renew us by your Holy Spirit. Unite us in the body of your Son and bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of never-ending praise. Friends, in confidence, we pray the great prayer that our risen Saviour taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. As this broken bread was once many grains which have been gathered together and made one bread, so may your church be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. We have the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, let us take this holy sacrament of the body and the blood of Christ. Eternal God, giver of life, in the breaking of the bread we know the risen Lord. May we who celebrate this holy feast walk in his risen light and bring new life to all creation. Risen Christ, your light shines in our hearts, our lives are in your hands. Take and use us in your service to the glory of your kingdom. Amen. Friends, just a couple of little notices. Firstly, next Thursday at 12 o'clock is the monthly lunchtime concert that will happen here. And so everyone is most welcome to come along. They're great, 3/4 an hour to an hour. Come along. If you are working, you can bring your lunch along and eat it here too. They're a great time to be had. Also, today marks the last day of my locum period. As of next Sunday, Reverend Graham Warren will be taking over as locum. So Graham will be here from today week, Sunday the 7th, so he will start. Many of you would know Graham from many years ago, some of you may not. And he has written a little note, well, a fairly long note really, isn't it, Gordon? But anyway, there are copies of it that you might like to take, and it's just an introduction to himself. So he will be starting next Sunday. So there'll be some of those available. And the other thing is just to have a wonderful, wonderful Easter day. I just hope you really enjoyed and be safe, especially if you happen to be travelling. I think you're saying something, are you?
Yes.
Right.
As John said, it's his last day today, and we have been so thankful and grateful that you came out of retirement to worship and lead us in worship. But we just got a small gift here for you and for Marg down there to share. You can go back into retirement. I don't know for how long.
A long time. Thank you.
So you notice that I do like a red wine. Okay. Thank you. Very good. So, friends, let's pray for God's blessing. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you what is pleasing in his sight, and may the blessing of the Almighty God, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. In the name of Christ.
Amen. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. And a final hymn, Yours Be the Glory.